I love these podiums. I had I'm a short person, so I have to make, adjustments. So I just want to welcome everyone to this conference and tell you how excited I am to be here with Jim Shelton. Jim Shelton was one of the first people I met. He runs the Office of Innovation and Improvement. And between the people in Washington, D.C., Jim and myself and Hal Plotkin and a couple of other champions, I think we have a team, Karen Cater, who actually worked with Jim and a lot of us to draft the educational technology plan that's out on our website, which you need to take a look at. And so we are really sort of pushing the envelope as much as we can to get, as your superintendent said, Superintendent Shumway, the highest quality education into the hands of every student here in the U.S. and everywhere else if we can. So I'm particularly excited to come here to this conference because I was one of the early followers of the work that MIT did and looked at what they were doing and said, you know, what if, and I did a lot of research on what it really took to pay faculty to write the very best content that they could and pay designers to work with those faculty and get that material in the hands of everyone who needs it. And so, oh, here we are. Oh, good. Thanks. Does this work? Yes. Okay. I want to have, that'll help. When the designers, you know, in my, 16-year career right after the internet, I started in Silicon Valley. So I sort of grew up with the Mosaic people and the Firefox people and Apple, and Steve Jobs was a student at our campus, and so was Steve Wozniak. And we just had, a huge amount of innovation. In fact, in our advanced technology, we opened the first advanced technology center, which actually had 10,000 students a day in that building learning. And in the front of that building, when you go in, we have a case that shows the original Apple logo that most people have never seen, which is the Garden of Eden and an apple hanging down and Eve pushing her hand up to it. And it also, we have a motherboard, there's one in the Smithsonian and one out in Silicon Valley. So, I mean, it's a history that I think a lot of us can share and appreciate, and certainly every time I turn on the TV now, you see Steve Jobs' story and all of that he brought to this endeavor. So, you know, why did I get into this? Why is Jim Shelton our champion in so many places around the country and around the world? Well, when President Obama took office, he said a phrase in February and then later in April. So he started on January 20th with Secretary Duncan. And then about a month later, he posited a view that the U.S. would strive to have the best educated, most competitive workforce in the world. And that really has stayed with me. We're 16th in the world now, you may not know. And so we are competing and we're getting out-competed academically and intellectually and technologically by folks in Singapore, by folks in China. I was just in London with 30 university presidents, half were from the UK and half were from the US. It was chaired by John Sexton at NYU, who started NYU Abu Dhabi. And all the conversation was about, you know, how to leverage what we know and the finest faculty around that we have, and how can we partner with other countries to actually share knowledge and push the world toward a democratic society in which we all would be able to live and thrive. And so it's a very serious security issue. It's a very serious academic issue. You know, competitiveness has to be leveraged. And so in Washington, what do we think about? Well, we think about the fact that we have a role to play in open education, and what can we do in Washington to really create systemic opportunities for open education to grow? And so that's no small task when you think about a whole country. And you think about, we have 6,200 colleges and universities in the U.S., and we have 100,000 K-12 schools. And so we think that's an enormous opportunity. And how can you create public and private markets that are going to push knowledge and get this knowledge into the hands of everyone, quite frankly? So that's the goal. And when you go to developing countries and you see what OER can do in terms of the health sciences and water and all of the social and economic problems that we have worldwide, it's such a tremendous opportunity to bring faculty together, to bring students together, and to share knowledge. So I was thrilled to hear Superintendent Shumway talk about science, because what this is doing is allowing faculty to be as creative as they can be. And if you've been in K-12 conversations, faculty feel beaten up. And I feel extremely sympathetic to them. And what has happened over many, many years, and it's not one administration, it's just what we have done to the education system, has been to create these micro bureaucracies where the faculty just have to take this cookie cutter curriculum and they don't have a lot of room to innovate. So when I hear that Utah is allowing faculty to use science, technology in K-12 schools and open education resources, I know that faculty can repurpose how they want to deliver that content. So they'll have access to the content, but they'll also have access to their own creative powers to really shape the kind of curriculum that their students need today in that classroom. So I think, for us, the open education resources movement really allows, on the one hand, tremendous innovation and creativity, and on the other hand, a system for all of us to work together in very new ways. So when the president says he wants us to have the best educated, most competitive workforce in the world, and I see the people, you had a slide up here, Flat World Knowledge, creating open content with services around that content. You see a lot of markets beginning to come and shape and grow and change, which is what we want for this movement. We also have so many schools and universities and people around the country who are in tiny places in rural America. And we're spending a lot of time on broadband to get everyone connected and satellites so that people can use the information that open education will really provide them. And so we know that in our work with Carnegie Mellon, we had a big conference. Arnie Duncan, our secretary, has a back-to-school tour every year. And this year, he decided we should have early learning K-12 and higher education, not just K-12. So we went to all of the Great Lakes states in 4 days. And one of the things we put together was a conference on cognitive science analytics at Carnegie Mellon. And they were showing the open knowledge that they had created, and they had a lot of professors who work in the cognitive sciences and work with the designers and work with the content experts, and they were showing some of the research, which is so important for us in Washington. I mean, one of our jobs is to actually share the knowledge in a very systematic way, as I said, so that you can have access to the research that's going to drive more momentum in open education. And so Candace Thill-Tile, who I don't know if she's here at this conference, but she has had some research where the Carnegie Mellon students in statistics, freshman statistics, learned the course in half the amount of time and did as well or better in the next course by having access to 24-hour online materials and actually having access to materials that actually will branch to what students know and don't know, so they're not wasting time on what they know. And I think this is really going to provide for all of us in education some new avenues to pursue with the scholarship that we have in BYU and our other fine universities across the country and our K-12 schools, who frankly are the laboratories for innovation. And most likely, much of the OER content will actually be repurposed by students. I know that many folks in the movement are talking about how graduate students find problems with the content that would take 3 years to fix in a traditional textbook and can be fixed immediately. So I think you can see I'm a champion for this. We need to help students get better, learn more. We're behind. I don't have to go into that. Students can learn faster, as some of the research is showing. And ultimately, what we want is students to have the best access to the highest quality materials so they can become the leaders of this next generation and beyond. I know many of you are intimately engaged in this process of thinking about the best way to build on these resources. And I'm hoping that you can become our champions. We're going to pretty soon, probably in a month or maybe a month and a half, by the holiday break, have what we're calling a request for information. And what we're asking the country, we're asking higher education to send us what is working and why and how you know. So what we want is a whole section on open education resources, how it's being used, and what evidence you're applying to demonstrate that it's being used well. It's going to help us sort out how we think about research and evidence and help us with the next phase. If you've ever gone to the What Works website that the Institute for Education Sciences oversees, it will hopefully be a very user-friendly type of What Works that will be very pragmatic, because our president wants us to become first in the world. And when President Obama says that, and I think about that, and I think we have 10 years to do this, and I think we need to have approximately, I like to round off to large numbers, 10 million more students graduating from college by 2020. If you do the math on that, it's 4% increase a year, but we know that increases come in waves. So we are looking at ways to really provide more access to higher education, better partnerships with K-12. We have too many students leaving K-12, got 25% dropping out in some of our urban and rural areas. 50% of kids are dropping out of high school. We lose a kid every 22 seconds. And so what we're hoping and wanting is the research that will say we can better articulate these pathways for young people, we can excite and inspire them. The teachers will be excited and inspired if they have science textbooks that are open, that they can actually manage and use and feel that content is getting to those students. And we'll have graduates that will be ready for the jobs and the opportunities ahead of us as a country. So I want to salute your efforts. Jim is going to tell you a lot more detail about what we're doing in Washington, but I'm going to just tell you a couple of things that I wanted you to know about internationally also. Hal Plotkin is a senior policy advisor. I think he's come to the conference before, and he wanted me to let you know that he recently met with Yang Zijian, who's president of the Open University of China. Can you imagine the Open University of China? And he has 3 million students in degree-seeking programs, 3 million. Actually, a side note, when I met with the Chinese delegation, the Minister of Education told me that they would soon be the largest English-speaking country in the world. In India, the Indira Gandhi Open University, which many of you may know as the People's University, is claiming similar numbers while offering more than 3,000 degree programs and 3,500 courses in a network of open and distance learning with 43 regional centers, 6 sub-centers, and 1,400 study centers all over India. I just came back from this meeting in London. India's plan is to build 15,000 universities. Many of them will be hopefully open universities, but if you can imagine the size and scope. So all of this work that you're doing is going to serve a huge global purpose that is going to bring, you know, India is our largest worldwide democracy. So our future is definitely going to be in part of their hands to some degree. And so as most of you know, though, we want to also create private sector innovation with open education. So we're asking not only other nations to join us, and I'm going to actually, we have a proposal before UNESCO and the OECD, the Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development, this next month, to be actually charting out how they're going to contribute to the open knowledge effort, and these goals together with OECD and UNESCO are going to hopefully help us connect scholars around the world for that world-class content that our students need. We also have a program, are you going to talk about Enter the Department of Energy? Okay, let me just mention this also. We're also working internally in Washington. We know there are way too many silos and there's just way too much bureaucracy. Just use an example, we're going to be regulating on teacher preparation. There are 440 requirements for a prospective teacher to meet, a federal requirements. One of them is that every prospective teacher must take the Myers-Briggs test. Now, I took the Myers-Briggs test. I'm an ENFJ, but I don't think that should be a requirement for prospective teachers. So we are looking to you, and this is sort of a larger plea or request from you, tell us what we can get rid of that makes no sense. We have a lot of, the department is 33 years old. We have a lot of stuff that just doesn't make sense for the 21st century. So if you have ways that we can streamline, we are going to go through a formal rulemaking process on, you know, certainly student loans and teacher preparation, and we have recommendations coming in on redesigning accreditation and the like, big hot topics for education. But we really want to hear from you. If you have ideas of things that are getting in the way and using open education, standards that we have, bureaucracies, legislation, mandates, regulations, we'd like to hear what ideas would be for repurposing those and making them better. But anyway, the Department of Energy is working with us to create a recently unveiled National Training and Education Resource, which is, it's called NTER, N-T-E-R. A sophisticated free online open source 3D platform for next generation online learning. And we've required, when we did a $500 million competition for community colleges this last year that Cable Green and others helped us think through, when we put out that first $500 million of what will be 4 years of competition, and that's another opportunity, we'll have another competition in the winter through the Department of Labor, and we're hoping you can put together some OER consortia with your partners in higher education, community colleges, and four-year universities that can benefit high schools also. We got some great proposals in the first round, and it's a lot of money. Everything that will be created will have to be open, and we'll have to use the CC BY platform from Creative Commons so that the derivative purposes can be allowed to be open. And so we're allowing public and private partnerships to participate in that, and we're hoping to create really the next generation of learning. So I think the Department of Energy, our relationship with them, we have a relationship with DOD, Jim Chilton has been enormously helpful in helping us. Can we get access to open knowledge that has been created over many years, for which there is research, for which we should be applying that to the education sector? So President Obama, 2 years ago, proposed the American Graduation Initiative. And I should read you actually what he said 2 years ago, because I think you can put in context everything that I've been talking about this morning. And I'm going to turn the microphone over to Jim in a minute. And so 2 years ago, right after taking office in July, he was in Michigan and at Macomb Community College, and he said, even as we repair brick and mortar buildings, which we're doing now with the American Jobs Act, we want to save teachers' jobs, save firefighters' jobs, and build out crumbling K-12 schools. We have an opportunity, he says, to build a new virtual infrastructure to complement the education and training that that colleges can offer. And we want to support the creation, in his words, of a new online and open source clearinghouse of courses so we can offer more classes without building more classrooms. This will make a difference for rural campuses that often struggle to attract students and faculty. It's going to make it possible for a professor to complement his lecture with an online exercise, or for a student who can't be away from her family to still keep up with her coursework. And then he says at the end, we don't know where this kind of experiment will lead, but that is exactly why we ought to try it. And so I think, you know, we have an administration that really wants to, as I said at the beginning, push the envelope and get the very best content into the hands of students. We are behind. If you look at the statistics for K-12 and higher education, we're losing half of the students who start in a higher education in a college or university. Half don't graduate in 6 years. People don't know that. We're really pushing. I was at the State University Conference yesterday in Boston, asking them, you know, we've got to get more students finishing their programs. Where is the big bottleneck? A couple. Too many underprepared students needing remedial courses that are out of date, and a testing system that's out of date also. So we need to modernize those systems in developmental education. There are a lot of online courses being created that are going to be much better than what we've had in the past. The faculty know best how to put this knowledge together. The designers can make it available, and we can test it and have the research to make sure it's going to work. So let me stop there. Let me turn this microphone over to Jim Chilton and tell you what a joy it is, David, to be here at the conference. I really urge you on. We also want visitors. Hal Plotkin wanted to make sure sure you knew that when you come to Washington, whether you're going to see the new Martin Luther King Memorial, which is unbelievable, or go to the museum, or any of the other great parts of Washington, D.C., come and visit us. Tell us what you're doing. Participate in the request for information when it comes out in the Federal Register. We'll make sure David can get the word out to all of you. And tell us what the research is that's driving the excellence that we need so badly, so desperately in this country. Thank you so much.